Jaime Woodward, Acting Commissioner of New York State Department of Taxation and Finance.
Thank you.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon or evening, as it may be. Chairman Kruger, Chairman Farrell, and distinguished members of the committee, I am Jaime Woodward, Acting Commissioner of the Department of Taxation and Finance. On behalf of Governor Patterson and the department's dedicated employees, I thank you for the opportunity to come before you today. Joining me are members of the department's executive staff, Robert Plattner, Deputy Commissioner of Office of Tax Policy Analysis, and Patricia Mitchell, the department's Chief Financial Officer. I would like to bring you up to date on many topics and issues that have consumed our days at the tax department in recent months. Last year's budget challenged us in many ways. By far, our most daunting challenge this past year, and the one that put the most significant strain on department resources, as well as taxpayers and tax practitioners, was the implementation of the Metropolitan Commuter Transportation Mobility Tax. Enacted in early May, the tax required us to be ready to receive retroactive payments on an entirely new tax by the end of October. Unlike some of the smaller new taxes we have successfully implemented in recent years, this major tax was to be collected from hundreds of thousands of employers, partners, and sole proprietors within the MTA region with estimated revenue of $1.5 billion for the MTA. As you can imagine, the department had to quickly reallocate resources dedicated to other projects and activities to meet the short time frame for implementation. I am immensely proud of our department's work in this area. Nevertheless, we are mindful of the difficulties this has caused taxpayers and tax practitioners, and we continue to improve the program as issues arise. In another new role for the department, we work closely with the Departments of Environmental Conservation and Health to develop procedures to implement the bottle bill amendments enacted with last year's budget. The legislation requires deposit initiators for all applicable beverage containers to register with the tax department by June 1. After nearly 8 months of legal challenges and court decisions changing implementation and filing due dates, a total of 236 deposit initiators have registered and paid over $22 million in unclaimed deposits. We were also in the forefront of tax administration as regards tax preparers this year. As you know, tax department investigations uncovered a shocking amount of tax fraud perpetrated by tax preparers. Last year, you passed a tax preparer registration program that also included the creation of a task force to determine possible educational and other standards for tax preparers. The work of the task force is underway, and we were pleased to see that the IRS recently announced a registration program as well. Our goal is to conform our program to that of the IRS to the greatest extent possible in order to minimize the burden on preparers while protecting the taxpayer. I would like to turn now to our latest legislative program, the PAID program, now in full swing until March 15th. Enacted as part of the deficit reduction plan, this program offers taxpayers with older outstanding liabilities an opportunity to pay significantly reduced penalties and interest that have accrued on tax bills if they act by the March deadline. Under the PAID program, no discount is given on the actual amount of tax due. In mid-January, at the start of the program, the department mailed approximately 700,000 letters of invitations to these eligible taxpayers. We have fielded thousands of phone inquiries, seen over 18,000 visits to our paid website, and accepted applications from approximately 8,000 taxpayers so far. In an attempt to collect revenue already owed to the state, rather than raise taxes, we are stirring up some very old matters. While the vast majority of liabilities involved are due and owing, we have become aware that there are some that, in fact, should be canceled. We will work with any taxpayer to review their matter with a goal of resolving it appropriately and expeditiously. The program will not only produce much-needed revenue, but it will also serve to reduce our old assessment inventory and allow us to better target our resources to pursue taxes owed to the state going forward. As I'm sure you're aware, over the past several years, the department has substantially improved its tax enforcement program as part of a strategy to narrow an unacceptable tax collection gap that results from underreporting of income, noncompliance, and even criminal behavior. Our strategic goal is simple. We are striving to create a smarter, more effective, and more credible presence that will deter noncompliance and increase voluntary compliance. Our approach involves both increasing the severity of the consequences for tax evasion while directing resources toward programs that encourage taxpayers to comply voluntarily. Our enforcement program is smarter because it is driven by more business intelligence and data analysis than ever before. The more information we have, the more we are able to select appropriate candidates for audit, find assets held by those who owe us legally collectible tax debt, and where appropriate, build stronger cases for criminal prosecution. The IRS estimates that when government lacks ready access to third-party data and other evidence of income, 54% of taxpayers underreport their income. In contrast, when government is provided information, such as W-2 wage information, 99% of taxpayers correctly report their income. The lesson is clear. More taxpayers will report when they know that underreporting can and will be detected. New laws enacted last year are just one step in giving us third-party information that we need to move more taxpayers in the direction of voluntary compliance. Legislation enacted in 2008 requires financial institutions to match their account data with our inventory of warranted tax debt. While all financial institutions are not yet fully compliant, given the results so far, we anticipate that this data match will produce $25 million in new revenue this current fiscal year. This year's executive budget includes an important proposal that seeks to require banks to send us the same aggregate credit card information that they are compiling for the IRS to further enhance our compliance efforts and to increase voluntary compliance. Equipped with new tools, we are sending more bills, conducting more audits, taking more collection actions, and initiating more criminal investigations than ever before. These efforts have returned huge dividends and have been supported through additional personnel resources added during these difficult fiscal times. We anticipate that in fiscal year 9-10, our activities will produce the highest recoveries in the state's history, approximately $2.75 billion in cash, including the revenues from the paid program. In addition, we expect that our fraud detection and pre-refund audits will save the state over $700 million. As we have increased and improved our enforcement program and collection capabilities in recent years, we have continued to devote resources to our core mission to promote voluntary compliance. We have sought to improve our outreach and educational programs and to provide more ways for taxpayers to bring disagreements or intractable tax problems to our attention outside of the collection and enforcement arena. To this end, and in consultation with members of the legislature last year, we installed our first taxpayer rights advocate. The Office of the Taxpayer Rights Advocate was established October 1, 2009, as an independent bureau within the Department of Tax and Finance, reporting directly to me. Its mission is to promote taxpayer rights, assist distressed taxpayers, advocate for the fair and reasonable administration of our tax laws, and to promote voluntary compliance by addressing inefficiencies and systemic flaws in our procedures. The Taxpayer Rights Advocate also seeks to help increase voluntary compliance through public outreach and education on key issues. Especially during these difficult economic times, the Taxpayer Rights Advocate plays a crucial role in our strategic plan. By ensuring fair, reasonable, and balanced enforcement, both taxpayers and the integrity of our system are preserved and protected. The Taxpayer Rights Advocate has already drafted legislation contained in the executive budget proposal to reform our Offers and Compromise program. The proposed legislation will provide the department with the tools needed to assist distressed taxpayers while generating increased revenues from otherwise uncollectible accounts. Last year, we assumed responsibility for the Office of Real Property Services, Human Resources, and Fiscal Matters. Expanding on this successful effort, the executive budget includes a proposal to consolidate ORPs with the Department of Taxation and Finance. We expect that the merger will result in further administrative savings, particularly in information technology, as well as facilities management. We are already working with ORPs to identify savings areas and efficiencies while maintaining our core missions. Also on the subject of cost savings initiatives, last year we notified taxpayers that we would not be mailing income tax forms and instructions automatically, as the majority of taxpayers, nearly 95%, access forms electronically, use software, or file taxes using paper bearers. The measure saved $1.2 million and had no adverse effects on filing behavior or revenue. Similarly, this year, we will ask taxpayers who itemized last year to use our website or to call us for their 1099-G state income tax refund information. We anticipate over $700,000 in printing and mailing savings as a result. In all areas of our contact with taxpayers, we will continue to encourage them to conduct their business with us using efficient technologies such as our website, email, and direct deposit options. Improvements in the way we communicate with taxpayers through clearer communications, streamlining our mail and print process, and using the web has resulted in approximately $5 million in cumulative savings. While we have provided web-based only filings for many of the new programs we have initiated, due to the breadth and scope of the MTA payroll tax, we offer both web and paper-based filing options. We will continue to convert taxpayers to online or electronic filing, and we'll keep you informed as we change our business practices. Finally, as you know, Governor Patterson included in his executive budget a proposal to raise the cigarette tax $1 per pack. In conjunction with that, he directed my department to issue regulations with respect to the sales by stamping agents to Indian sellers. I am pleased to report to you today that these regulations will be proposed shortly. We anticipate that the full regulatory process will take approximately 6 months to complete. While I am prepared to speak to questions you may have with regard to the regulatory process, I respectfully refer you to Peter Kiernan, counsel to the governor, for questions you may have on substantive Indian matters. With that caveat, I will be happy to answer any questions you may have. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Questions?
Yes, Senator.
I think we first passed the cigarette tax back in 2000, passed a law for the enforcement of the tax on Indian Nations in 2005. And if I recall correctly, at that time, the law basically codified the existing regulations. And there were regulations in effect at that time. Am I correct in that? And if I am, what are we doing for the next 6 months if there's already regulations that have been constructed and prior legislation?
I think in basic concept, you're correct of what was codified back a few years ago. There are a few more details that it's appropriate to put in regulations that we are in discussions, in final discussions with the governor's council's office as to what should be in the regulation. And just to be a little more expansive on, the regulatory process is controlled by the State Administrative Procedure Act, which requires, and for good reason, some timing and filings that are required in certain orders. And the proposed regulations will be out very shortly. What takes the time for the 6 months that we're estimating is a comment period and then time to reflect upon the comments to make any adjustments to regulations. That the typical time frame for a regulation is approximately 6 months. So the regulations will be out very shortly in a draft proposal form, and then we will have time for comment and reflection on those comments before they are finally adopted.
But are you working off regulations that have previously been created but never adopted?
We are looking at, yes, we are using those as our basis, yes.
All right. I just hope, and I'm not making any accusation here, but it just seems like every time we get a commitment from a governor, and I remember when Governor Spitzer gave the same commitment, and Governor Pataki and everyone else, it seems that always there was always a delay for some reason, and then we never get the process started. And I just hope this regulatory process is not another way to delay this thing. And I'm not suggesting from the tax department. I'm suggesting from the entire government. Because this has been called for a long time. Tax auditors. There's been a steady increase in the number of auditors that have been authorized in the last three budget cycles. Like if I counted them correctly, it's almost 600. Have they all been hired? And if so, what has been the result? I mean, is there any kind of results you can show as a result because of the increased auditing capabilities?
Well, I think as I mentioned in the testimony that this year we will bring in the most collections ever in our history. So, yes, they are a big part of that process. Have they all been hired? That may be, we are still in the hiring process, and we have hired up several times as we get authorization to hire. But as you all know, as you hire, there are different people who leave at different times. They retire or take other positions. So it's a constant process of keeping caught up with our audit staff. And we do have quite a few at work, yes.
And as far as you understand, is the auditors that are being hired, that's not part of the governor's hiring freeze? Is that exempt from the hiring freeze, or are you being stopped now from hiring new people?
We have gotten approval from the Division of the Budget to hire the positions of auditors and others that support the collection and the revenue process.
And in your prepared remarks, I was kind of fading off because I... people read every remark. I just kind of lose my attention. But I guess my point with that is, did you give an idea of how much the increased revenues have been with these new auditors, or just that it's record increase? Did you give numbers?
Well, I think
or can you give us some idea to show that these auditors have been worth the money? I mean, is there dollars that you can point to that you've been able to collect because of the increase?
I believe what's in the executive budget is that with the addition of 341 positions in the department, an additional $221 million was added to the revenue.
And is that supported by when 200 auditors were in the 207-208 budget, and an additional 190 and 95 in the 208-209, were there corresponding increases that are consistent with what the governor is predicting by adding more auditors?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Jimmy, Assemblyman Hayes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Commissioner Woodward. I just have two quick questions that I want to ask you. First and foremost, we're beginning the tax filing season for income taxes for most New Yorkers. Can you tell us how the department is set up to process those returns? Given the cash flow concerns that we've had in other areas of the state at the end of the year, can you categorically tell taxpayers today that they won't be delayed in getting their refund checks due to the state's cash problems?
Well, we are processing the income tax returns as we do every year, usually just after Martin Luther King weekend is when the federal government turns on their system and we turn ours on too. And we have been processing and we are beginning to issue the refunds. I can say that we work closely with the Division of the Budget with the cash management process, and to date we have a plan that will allow us to continue to issue refunds through this March.
On time, as has been the custom in the past? In other words, you know, one of the biggest concerns that people have, and I want to make sure I'm clear about asking this question, is that in December the governor withheld aid payments to school districts and municipalities citing a cash crunch. He said that in January that would be over because we're going to get tax receipts that are going to come to the state. Mm-hmm. Of course, that's an estimate of what tax receipts will be coming to the state. And people who are looking for their refunds and who file on a timely basis are looking forward to receiving their refund on a timely basis should they be owed one. The question I have for you is the department prepared to send out those refunds on a timely basis?
Well, and I think, as you know, every year there is a cap to the amount of refunds that get paid out during the January through March time frame, and then additional refunds are paid out through April. So typically it depends on exactly when you file a return, how much of a wait you have. But clearly the statute requires that the timely filed returns receive their refund within a statutory time frame, and we do expect to always meet that time frame. Yes.
Thank you. The last question really is following up on Senator DeFrancisco's question. I think the issue is really trying to get our arms around the additional appropriation for the personnel in the department, mostly in the audit department, that the money that's being expended is actually not just collecting more than we've ever collected in the past, but how is that actually working in terms of the progression? Because the overall tax collection to the state is down from what the state budget predicted, isn't that right?
Well, I think where we've seen the weakness in the revenue numbers are what's coming in on returns and what's coming in withholding amounts, what we consider the voluntary side of people making their payments for taxes. the auditors and the other staff that we have that go to collect the money, they are, and we clearly account for it separately, producing more and more revenue. And when we hire an additional auditor or collector, they generate 13 or 14 times their cost in the first year. There are some ramp-up issues of training folks and making sure that they have adequate knowledge of our complex tax laws where they're doing their work. And so that is quite a challenge for us right now. Approximately 20% of our staff have very 1 year or less experience at this point in those areas. So we are trying to make sure we target and carefully supervise the work that they do. But that revenue and the return, the money that comes in from that is clearly, we can sit down and talk to anyone who'd like to see how we account for it. It's a separate, we call it our CARTS money, but it's our accounts receivable money, and it clearly goes up as we hire the additional staff and put them to work.
And random audits that the department conducts, there always seem to be constituents who call the legislative offices after receiving a random audit letter from the department who, you know, in the back of their minds, I know there's two sides to every story, and I know that most of that stuff is confidential. We can't even get involved in it. We ask you to take a look at it. We do appreciate the department looking into the matter, making sure the contact is made with the taxpayer. But when we have all of these new auditors who come on board, the public kind of thinks, oh, well, there's going to be all these wild goose chases now with people subjected to random audits who, for no reason, should be subject to them. Is that the department's policy, or when they conduct an audit, send out an audit letter, there's actually a reason for it?
No, we don't have a policy of goose chase audits. In fact, the folks who are brought on are given, they're assigned the cases that they're supposed to work, and we have folks who are looking through a lot of the data that we have to determine where an appropriate use of our resources is. And so we very much do have programs that we target. Because of the great desire to bring in the revenue and to have more compliance on the amount that folks pay into us, we have started some audit programs in new areas, carefully monitored by the folks in central office, that target items such as the cash-based businesses and sales tax. Whereas before, a lot of our revenue was generated by the big companies and doing audits that last several years, our cycle has quickened now, and we are focusing and diversifying our audit process to make sure that folks know when they're collecting the sales tax on behalf of the state of New York, they need to turn that over to us. And that just because they're a small company or a small business does not mean that they will never be looked at by the tax department. So we're trying to create and keep the level playing field for everyone by not just targeting, you know, the audit that's the quickest or the easiest for us. Not that we always do that, but we certainly put more emphasis on using our data and doing some either territorial or business-based kind of sampling of where are some things that look out of whack, and we're using a lot more data and data analysis, as I mentioned, to look for outliers by comparing like businesses and trying to only look at the ones that say, well, this one looks way out here and someone looks way out here. And you have to look at them to see which one maybe they could be both right, and we go into an audit looking at it like that. But there could be things that either one of on either extreme indicate something that we need to learn and to help the taxpayer pay the right amount, and also maybe to adjust how we're educating the public or what their obligations are.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Commissioner, I have
done it. Some three questions. Earlier today, I received a note that says that I would like to stress, I guess this note was relative to you, that I would like to stress that it is vital that we collect all revenues legally owed us and that we enforce all state tax laws that are currently effective, including taxes on Native American-owned retail establishments. Since our ranker pointed out he gave me the year of 2005, can you tell me why we haven't been collecting the taxes between now and 2005?
Well, I don't know that we agree that we haven't been collecting the taxes. I think there is agreement that perhaps not all taxes have been collected the way everyone sees. But as you know, the matter is a very complex and a long history behind the taxation of products that go to Indian reservations and that come off the reservation by other individuals. We have been working, the governor's office has been working very diligently on addressing this issue, and I do think that we are changing the nature of the discussion at this point, and look forward to issuing our draft regulations.
Well, you say it's complicated. Why is it complicated?
Because there are many viewpoints as to Indian sovereignty and what laws apply and treaties, and frankly, we have always looked to the governor's office for guidance as to how that matter is to be handled.
Does the governor have to sign a letter of forbearance that would allow the tax department to start collecting the taxes?
Pardon me?
There's a forbearance letter that has to be signed by the governor that would release the department and allow you to start collecting taxes. Is that correct?
Well, excuse me. Actually, it's an advisory opinion that had been previously issued by the tax department that needs to be reversed, and that the governor is coordinating that as he publicly announced that we would be.
What was the advisory opinion?
What was it?
Right.
It was an opinion that dealt with the taxation of products that flowed to Indian sellers.
So untaxed product?
Yes.
How much do you estimate a year we are losing by not collecting those taxes?
I think we've submitted testimony before that the maximum amount we could collect from, you know, sort of a full-blown program of enforcement would be $200 million a year state and $20 million local.
In other words, is your estimation that the large manufacturers are supplying the so-called smoke shops with the amount of product that you would only be able to tax to the level of $200 million a year?
We think that, yes, first of all,
why do you say you think? You either know or you don't know. Because, I mean, if they're giving you the numbers as to what they're shipping, so how much are they shipping?
Right now, based on most recent information, in 2008, there were 27 million cartons of untaxed cigarettes going to the reservation.
27 million cartons.
Right.
27 million cartons. Let's focus on that number. And how much tax is there per carton?
Well, the tax per pack of cigarettes is $2.75. But the situation is such that, you know, there are other sources of untaxed cigarettes. You can purchase untaxed cigarettes through the internet. You can purchase from other black market sources.
Isn't it the case that the manufacturer is not shipping to anyone other than to a middleman, what I call a revenue agent, and it's the revenue agents that ultimately supply this, hopefully the stamped product, obviously a lot of unstamped product to the smoke shops. The large manufacturers are not selling to internet subscribers. Isn't that the case?
That's true.
So then how much are we talking about in terms of that manufacturing?
I don't think I understand the question.
Well, we'll try to break it down a little simpler. If we're talking about the numbers that you're talking about, then certainly we're not talking about $200 million, because that would mean that we were taxing cigarettes at about a dollar a pack. But since we're taxing them at a much higher level than a dollar a pack, let's just blow away the $200 million before we even get started. Then we could start talking about the handful of revenue agents that are licensed by the department that virtually show little or no product that's being shipped from the manufacturer that they're buying stamps for, and it's going directly to the smoke shops. Now, is there any effort being made to deal with those revenue agents to find out why they are getting product from the manufacturer and sending them directly to the smoke shop without buying stamps?
I think you're misunderstanding that, just because, which is the number of, cartons of unspent cigarettes has actually gone down from 47 million in the high in 2005 to something less than 27 million, and yet the number of New York state taxed where there are stamp sales is also going down. There are a number of
factors. Because we're encouraging people not to smoke.
Yes, so.
That's a good thing. Ultimately, yeah. We would hope we collect no money at all. But what we want to do is we want to penalize those people that are paying the taxes and add a dollar a pack, while at the same time, we're now trying to develop regulations that would allow us to, in the future, while we're sitting here today based on anyone's numbers, today's hearings probably cost the state of New York at least $3 million worth of cigarettes that have just fallen into the black hole of Calcutta because they haven't been taxed. And my question is, as the tax enforcing agency, I ask you why they haven't been taxed. And I'm not getting an answer. And I asked you that in terms of a FOIL request. And we've got some numbers, but not a lot of numbers. And those numbers do not jive anywhere near what the manufacturer's numbers are. So I guess the next step is subpoenas, both to the manufacturer, to the agencies, to the revenue agents, as well as the smoke shops, so that the committee can eventually start putting together the pieces to find out which is probably $1 billion a year, if not more, criminal enterprise that is going untaxed in this state. And for far, far too long, if we want to assume even 2005, and if we want to take the most outlandish numbers, as you say, the numbers have been going down, but they were even at their high point, we've lost billions of dollars of money that should have gone in to education, to health care, and to every other program that we have to cut because of the inaction in the collection of these taxes, besides the health issues, the fact that, you know, the American Cancer Association, the American Lung Association, and the physicians' groups, everybody is weighing in on this issue. We spend millions of dollars a year in Medicaid funds for smoking cessation programs. Yet at the same time, this agency is allowing millions of packs of untaxed cigarettes to wind up on the streets of this city, this state, and you know what? It's going to stop. It's going to stop. And it's not going to stop because of your regulations, because it shouldn't take 6 months to promulgate regulations when the United States Supreme Court has ruled, when the Court of Appeals has ruled, when this legislature has ruled, and when all the governor has to do is sign a piece of paper, the attorney general is prepared to go into court to lift the injunction, the agents are prepared to buy the stamps, and you know the process of all of this rigmarole that there's going to be blood in the streets and terror on the highways. There should be no more terror on the highways than someone that lives in Westchester and doesn't want to pay their property tax and they threaten to burn tires on the Springbrook, or someone that would threaten to burn tires in Nassau County on the Long Island Expressway. At the end of the day, what we face here is a crisis in management. And the buck stops with the state tax department. Because if not, then they have to say it's the governor that's not enforcing it. We don't need more regulation. We need to have a comment period. We've gone through all of this. What we need to do is to collect the taxes. And we're not doing it. And 6 months is a stall. There isn't a dollar of money in revenue stream in this year's budget based upon the uncollection of those taxes. 6 months, even by your numbers, is reprehensible. Because even using your number, $100 million, that means $100 million of health care money that we're taking, $100 million worth of teachers that we're threatening to rip out of the classroom. It's unconscionable. It's unconscionable. Thank you.
Senator? Yes, I just, I asked similar questions, maybe a little less strenuously, but I just wanted to make sure that I understand what you said, that the governor's council and the governor makes these decisions. You work for the governor, and if the governor tells you to start enforcing, you're going to enforce. Is that a fair statement?
We are following the governor's directive, yes.
Thank you.
Senator?
Thank you. Well, I have many questions, but I know the time is late, so I may just cover some things briefly and follow up with you afterwards. Following up on the earlier questions about getting more auditors and collecting more taxes, in your testimony, you actually say approximately $2.75 billion in cash, including revenue from the PAVE program, was generated in 2009-10 through recovery. So that's not necessarily the outcome of X number of new auditors, but you're saying you had new auditors, and in fact, then you were able to have the greatest amount of recoveries in history, and that was $2.75 billion. Is that just correct?
Yes.
Okay. So we're growing the number of auditors, finding people who aren't paying their taxes, and I don't know about everybody else, but I get pissed off when people don't pay their taxes. Apparently my colleague, Senator Carlson, also does on a different theme. Where are we finding the greatest growth in recovery? What are the lessons to be learned here about who is not paying their taxes proportionally, and perhaps help me think about what more we should be doing in New York State to ensure that everyone pays their taxes, because as was just said, when some people don't pay their taxes, we in the legislature end up cutting education, health care, and emergency services.
Mm-hmm. Well, as I mentioned a little in my testimony, where we see the biggest gaps are where we don't have other information sources to match up with, which is why last year we came and received some additional third-party reporting information. Really, the statistic from the IRS that without any reporting, 54% tell third-party reporting, 54% tell the right income, and when you have W-2 wage reporting, it goes up to 99%. It's kind of a sad statement that we can't trust people to say things without them knowing somebody has something to that will match up with. But that is why we have interest statements that come to us. There's lots of statements we're used to getting. But we feel that going in the areas where businesses are buying products from their suppliers and the volume of the product that they're buying, it gives you an indication of what kind of sales might be going on in that business. They wouldn't keep buying whatever product it is to manufacture or to sell without having business going on with that. So those are the things we asked for last year, a couple of initiatives, and it was enacted into law, and we are working on getting that information from those suppliers. So really, to us, it's the cash-based business. It's the people, you know, there's a lot of self-employed folks, and the more we get information that relates to things that we can tie together to say, okay, this looks about right, that's fine, or here's some information that we have that doesn't appear reflected on a tax return. Those are the areas where if we can develop other sources of third-party reporting and have the reporting come to us for us to put in into the computers to figure out what isn't matching up, it will allow us to determine a better avenue of where we need to focus our work.
And following up on that, I mean, in addition to, you know, letting me know at some point, and my colleague John DeFrancisco was also interested, other things that we could do to help you. There was a hearing the other day about businesses paying people either off the books or defining people not as employees but rather consultants, so that they didn't have to pay certain benefits. But one of the things that came out of the hearing that struck me from looking at the testimony was, in fact, New York State loses an enormous amount of tax revenue that way also. And has your department looked into that question about what we could be doing under state law to ensure that people are correctly categorized as employees from the perspective of Zentax and collecting the right taxes from them?
We have had discussions of how to get our arms around a way to make sure we could shrink that gap. Our focus is always about shrinking the gap of from what should be collected to what isn't reported, to keep reducing that. But there is some reporting required on someone who hires a contractor to do some work for them, but we have not found a perfect solution to get to some of that where the reporting could be clearly where people would understand their responsibilities. But we would love to work with you or your staff to see if there's some other avenue we could come up with, even to address a slice of that. So that would be
appreciated. Because I have some testimony from the hearing talking about up to $500 million is through tax evasion for employee misclassification. I'll be happy to get you the material. Last year, the governor proposed one form of sugar soda tax, which was a sales tax per, I guess, unit of drink. And this year, he proposed a soda tax that's an excise tax per ounce. I believe I have that right. And some people are saying the flaw with this is that they simply will manufacture across state lines and escape the tax. Am I not understanding excise tax? Even if you manufacture out of state, if you're selling in state, we still get to collect that tax, don't we?
Exactly, right. It's more on the first import of the syrup or into the state, so that it would not at all drive that business out of the state. In fact, the mechanisms would be to say that, in fact, if you go out of state to bring it in, you're still going to owe the tax.
So you might, not you, you're the legislature, we might argue pro or con any individual tax and tax rate, but no one's going to physically move their facilities to avoid the tax. They might choose to stop selling their product in New York State to avoid paying the tax, but then they wouldn't be selling their product to some percentage of 19 million New Yorkers. I have that logically right?
Yes. I mean, we intend to collect tax whether you make that syrup out of state or you are bottling in state. One way or the other, we're going to be collecting tax on that.
That was my understanding. Since I was being told something different, I just wanted to ask the experts and get that straight. The governor has proposed a severance tax on the Marcellus Shale natural gas that we might or might not drill ever, and I'm one of those people who don't think we should be drilling it. But why don't we propose a severance tax on the other natural resources we pull out of our ground as well? We pull oil and coal out of the ground in New York State. Why just one product versus the host of products?
I actually don't know how much coal and oil we pull out of the ground in New York. I do know that a decision was made. There is some oil, I mean some gas that's produced out of existing vertical wells that are have been operating for a long time and produce a modest amount of gas, and for policy reasons that, you know, didn't come from the tax department, I would say that's the one place where clearly there is a kind of natural resource that's being taken out of the ground that we've chosen not to tax while we're going to be taxing the new Marcellus Shale activity.
Earlier today, and I think you were sitting here all day, so I think you might have heard this, there was a panel advocating for the expanded film tax credits that the governor proposed, and someone made the statement, I actually think it was my colleague assembly member Lentall, I mean he's not here so I don't want him to speak, but I believe he said so finally a tax credit we're actually making money and we don't have any other tax credits where we make money for the state. One, is that true that it's a tax credit that makes us money, and two, is it the only one we've ever come up with, because we have something like $40 billion in tax expenditures on our books. So I'm just wondering if that's the one that we actually make money on and not the rest?
I would say that, you know, those are controversial, and my guess is that for people benefiting from the other credits, they might be able to put together or have put together some kind of report from a consultant indicating that that the tax credit more than pays for itself. I think, you know, there is an Ernst & Young study that was commissioned by the industry that does suggest that the tax credit more than pays for itself. I will say that there have been studies done on film credits in other industries, and it's a pretty mixed bag of results as to whether these credits pay for themselves or not.
And in fact, every year you put out a tax expenditure, right, document, and some of us read through it. More people should. You should look at the tax expenditure budget. And you have coding in there I guess, ranking the credibility you have in the estimate of what the cost of the state is. I guess it's like a 1 through 4.
Yeah, sometimes our information is very good, so we can say pretty clearly that this is what something costs us. So, you know, we can just add up what's mm-hmm. on returns. Other times we have less reliable way, and so our level of confidence is lower.
So the same way that you're improving your agency's ability to collect taxes that previously eluded you through computer matching and other third sources of data, I'm just wondering, can New York State get better at evaluating what these tax expenditures are, A, actually costing us, and B, what the economic activity they're generating are? I mean, is the science out there improving for evaluating this so that we in the legislature can better understand, and I hope more closely provide oversight of saying year by year, well, that one's working very well. That one's costing us a lot of money. That one worked very well in 1987, but doesn't make sense in 2010. I'm really wondering whether we have a sort of a 21st century model going forward for how we make, how we do the correct analysis and how we do good evaluations on both what our tax policy is bringing in, but also what our tax policy is not bringing in.
Well, we generally are only asked to do the first part of that, you know, accurately as we can determine what the size of the tax expenditure is. It's generally not been seen as part of our reporting responsibilities, and it would be quite a different exercise to make some attempt to then say, and this is what we get in return. And for the most part, you know, we have not been asked to do that in our tax expenditure report, only reports on what it's costing us, and it would require, you know, a different kind of study to try to make an attempt to figure out what we're, or how, you know, what the size of the benefits are.
And finally, in our tax expenditure report, that is, that's in statute, right? We must do that every year, so we could, in fact, change what the statute requires.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Senator. Bob Simminger.
Dr. Plattner, you mentioned Ernst and Young, is it there?
Yes.
An Ernst and Young study in regard to the film tax credit?
Yes.
That was about the film tax credit here in New York State?
Yes.
Yeah. Did you all hire Ernst and Young to do that report?
I believe the industry hired Ernst & Young to do the report with some cooperation from the Office of
Film. Could the film industry have hired, let's say, the public policy people, the tax policy people at the Federal Reserve Bank? Could they have hired them? Do you hire the Federal Reserve Bank to do studies?
No. I don't know whether they'd be interested in a particular study like that. Certainly, the industry could have hired any number of, you know, people with econometric skills.
I hold in my hand a Federal Reserve Bank of Boston study on the Connecticut film tax credit, which my jaw dropped when I read it. It debunks this whole concept that this is a tax break that pays for itself and so on. Are you aware of the Federal Reserve in our region doing a study?
I don't
Would
believe.
Would that be instructive if they did? And
credible
if they did?
I have no idea about that. I would say that I am aware that there have been other studies done of other film credits in other states, some have which have concluded that they don't pay for themselves. The Ernst & Young study indicates that that the credit does more than pay for itself, but would it benefit from having some other study done by an academic organization? Or it's always nice to get another opinion, I guess.
Thank you.
Thank you.